So thank you very much for such nice welcome. I'm very grateful to you for inviting me here. I'll try to convince myself it's 7 o'clock in the evening. So today I thought to present to you some ideas which I found in Father Sofroni and Father George's correspondence. It's a very interesting document. They started their correspondence in 1929. And I think the last letter was written in 1960s sometimes. I am very pleased that the topic that you have chosen, how does theology relate to asceticism, is chosen and the conference takes place in this monastery. Because Father Sofroni, his legacy, and Father Sofroni as a theological and ascetic figure, is a very, very appropriate topic to give us, as to present as an example, when his personal ascetic experience and his intellectual formulation are merged into a single whole. I think it was a providence of God that Father Sofroni was given this name, Sofroni. If you know in Greek, Sofroni, Sofrosini, means chastity. But the Slavonic translation of the word is very interesting. It means integrity, wholeness. And I think in Father Sofroni, we find this wholeness, this unity of mind and heart, which is so essential for theology. The same could be said of Father George Florovsky. Though he was very well versed in academic issues, he would never lose sight of what true theology means. His remarkable expression, patristic mind, is now part of Orthodox legacy. It puts the stamp of authenticity that sealed Orthodox theology ever after. I start my presentation with personal memories. When I arrived in Essex, Father Sofroni, during our very first conversations, asked me whether I would like to study theology. And I said, of course, Father Sofroni, it was my dream. I'm very happy. And he made all the provisions for me to start my theological education. But then he noticed I was too eager on reading theology and reading the fathers and also modern theology. He was concerned that the balance in my spiritual life is not distorted. And he told me that the true theology is a synthesis of your ascetical experience as well as your intellectual knowledge. And this antinomy, which I experienced in Father Sofroni's attitude to theology and asceticism, runs throughout all his writings. On the one hand, he was fully engaged in the most contemporary theological issues of his time, but yet he would never accept any of the ideas of modern theology which are not confirmed by the ascetic experience of the church and by his own experience. He would have a kind of a filter in his heart and then in his mind, which would reject or accept any dogmatic finding of his contemporaries. He was very sensitive to any theological dissonance. For example, he wouldn't really agree with Bulgakov's model of the Trinity or he would be rather suspicious of Losky's ideas of divine darkness as the most central element of Orthodox ascetic experience. On the other hand, Father Sofroni would immediately react positively to any idea which was inspired, as he believed, by God to the minds of those theologians, of Russian theologians in particular. For example, he liked and developed the ideas of Komiakov's subornest, or Bulgakov's and Florensky's idea as theology as knowledge as communion. But and also we see that in Father Sofroni's theology, all these issues through his ascetic experience were brought to its final perfection, to its final completion. For example, the idea of subornest in Father Sofroni's mind was applied not only to church, but to the whole of mankind as a reflection of divine subornest. This is by way of introduction. Now we come to the actual correspondence. The first letter was written in 1929. Father Sofroni wrote to Father George. 1929, it was a year before Father Sofroni met St. Silvan in the monastery. Of course they met, but they never spoke until 1930. And I think this is very important detail, that Father Sofroni's theological education and his theological training preceded his encounter with St. Silvan. I believe that without his theological training, which Father Sofroni received in Paris, academic training, he wouldn't be able to detect in St. Silvan the most distinctive contemporary theological figure. Yes, I'm not afraid to say theological figure. Even though St. Silvan was a very simple peasant, but some of the ideas have profound theological meaning. For example, Christ-like humility. This is theological concept par excellence. Who before St. Silvan would assert that God is humility? And further on, if we speak about other aspects of St. Silvan's teaching, for example, love for one's enemies as the most distinctive trait of Orthodoxy. No one before St. Silvan would choose this particular element of Orthodox spirituality as the most, I would say, most essential. If you don't love your enemies, you are not Orthodox, for St. Silvan. Not only, I wanted just to draw your attention that Father Sofroni's encounter with St. Silvan was preceded, but also followed by Father Sofroni's engagement with academic theology. Thanks to Father Sofroni's academic crunch, if I may say so, the teaching of St. Silvan entered most contemporary academic arena. He brought it into dialogue with contemporary issues. And I'm sure, and I'm convinced, that without theological training and academic theology, it would be an impossible task. Father George Fulorovsky, he was one of those theologians who would agree with Father Sofroni that St. Silvan is an important theological figure. I don't know if you know, when Father Sofroni left Mount Athos in 1947 with this treasure, the writings of St. Silvan, he presented these notes to various theologians like Madame Lotte Baratin or Vladimir Lossky. And their reaction was predictable. Madame Lotte Baratin said, well, ce n'est pas rien, mais folklore pieuse. It's nothing, it's just folklore, pious folklore. The same said Vladimir Lossky about Saint-Sylvain's writings. So, for Father Sofroni, it was a tremendous challenge to present the writings of Saint-Sylvain to the modern academic world. Remarkably, Father George Florovsky was a true theologian who would immediately spot the importance of Saint-Sylvain's writings. He writes in his correspondence, he writes in his introduction to the first publication of Saint-Sylvain's writings in English. Sylvain spoke usually about common things. Yet, about the common things, he spoke in a very uncommon manner. He spoke out of his intimate experience. And Father George pinpointed the most important points. Love, he writes, is both the starting point and the core of Christian endeavor. But the novelty of the Christian love is so often overlooked and disregarded. According to Christ himself, the only true love is love for the enemies. Also, it was Father George, with his profound theological intuition, who detected in this remarkable focus of Saint-Sylvain on divine humility as something which has very profound significance. For him, Saint-Sylvain showed that humility is not only a virtue of a pious monk. Humility is an attribute of the divine being. It is an indispensable condition of our own deification. One point which Father Sofroni and Saint-Sylvain would agree, Father Sofroni and Father George would agree very much, is their perception of the Church dogmatic legacy. For neither of them, it was a mere intellectual discipline. Dogmas of the Church are the supreme articulation of the divine revelation. Father Sofroni would always notice, or would always focus on our creed. The very creed of our faith, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, and so on, is the collation of highly complicated dogmas. Speak about terms like homoousios. It is highly complicated terminology. Yet, they are not a product of intellectual or logical manipulation, but a verbal articulation of our faith, of our experience. And Father Sofroni, in his writings, would draw our attention that the Saint Athanasius of Alexandria believed and demanded that without assimilating these highly complicated dogmas into our living experience, our salvation is impossible. Unfortunately, if we go in our Orthodox world, outside this academic world, academic walls of the monastery here, we'll find sometimes very little interest to the dogmatic legacy of the Church. And Father George suffered very much in this environment, which was sometimes very much indifferent to this treasure and bounty of Orthodox dogmatics. All of us have to bear the cross of loneliness, he writes to Father Sofroni. Therefore, I would be delighted to discuss with you theological issues by correspondence. On the other end of the Atlantic, Father Sofroni found himself in a similar situation. He writes, by your expression about the cross of loneliness that we have to bear, you struck at the very core of what I feel at this very moment. There are hardly any such minds and souls which would leave dogmas, that is, those who are theologians in their inner predisposition. Life and dogma. Today, I believe it is the central point of this symposium. For Father Sofroni, church dogmas became his typical. They would define his life. It was the rule and basis of his daily life. Father Sofroni shares this vision with his friend David Balfour. I'm sure many of you might have read his recently published correspondence with David Balfour. There, Father Sofroni writes, three things I cannot understand. These are, firstly, non-dogmatic faith, secondly, non-ecclesiological Christianity, and finally, non-ascetic Christianity. The church, dogma, and asceticism constitute one single whole to me. And Father Sofroni would never accept any abstraction in theology. This became particularly obvious in his correspondence with professors of St. Sergius Institute. As many of you might know, that Father Sofroni sent his monks for theological training. Among the places where he would send his monks would be Institute of St. Sergius. And the presence of monks among the students wasn't met with enthusiasm. Some of the professors would treat monks with certain contempt. These are so-called progressive theologians. And Father Sofroni wrote a very harsh letter to them, and he said, I quote, there should be no space for snobbish intellectuals in our church. Shining in lounges with their eloquence, they afford themselves to speak of eschatological maximalism of monasticism, while themselves being ignorant of that way of life, having never touched this heavenly fire, not even with the tip of their finger. They trade the sacred holiness of monasticism for the sake of their own glory, bending the names of our fathers as playthings. After this letter, the attitude changed drastically. Life and dogma. What is the prime dogma that defines our life? May I dare to ask, do you have any opinion? What dogma should be defining our life? How does it relate to us? Well, Father Sofroni raised this issue in correspondence with Father George. For Father Sofroni, it was the dogma of the Trinity and its interpretation. For Father George, it was Christology. Let us shortly assess their arguments. Father Sofroni writes that the life of each and every Christian confession is conditioned at all levels by its conception of the Holy Trinity. Differences in theological interpretation of the principle of the person, hypostasis, within the Trinity, within the divine being, constitute a watershed, a demarcation line, not only between the various religions, but even between the sundry Christian confessions too. How does the dogma of the Trinity affect our life? And Father Sofroni, in order to show it, refers to Catholic spirituality. He shows us the difference in our spiritual life to demonstrate how the vision and the dogma of the Trinity affects our spirituality. For him, all the phenomena within the Catholicism were determined by Latin misconceptions about the Holy Trinity. He writes, every time when in our perception of the divine being, means in the Holy Trinity, we distort the equilibrium between identity and difference given to us in the Bible, we inevitably introduce this disequilibrium in our life, in our being, both on historical and eternal level. I don't know if any of you have read a book by Philip Sherard called The Greek East and Latin West. In his book, he has a very striking statement. Philip Sherard writes that Roman Catholic triadology and anthropology are responsible for all maladies of modern society. Oh, it's a very sweeping statement. But Father Sofroni invites us to consider and to assess this statement. How is it possible? One of the major problems with Latin triadology is, of course, filioque. The Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and from the Son. Insignificant. Not for Father Sofroni. He believed that this clause, this very tiny detail, distorts the very nature of personhood within the Trinity and within us as human beings. If the Holy Spirit proceeds from the dyad of the Father and the Son, which means he proceeds more or less from their nature, from them as a unit, it acquires elements of energy. This denies to the Holy Spirit the fullness of his personhood. And this Augustinian model of the Trinity establishes priority of essence, of nature, over person, personal, over personhood. What would it mean for us if we give priority to general over personal? Well, very direct result is Marxism. And I, being brought up in the Soviet Union, I can tell you it's very painful to go through this prism of vision of human being when you are defined as a determined being, determined by material nature. Human being is far more than this. And Father Sofroni stressed how this idea that the nature is more important, general, is more important than personal, is reflected in the institution of the Catholic Church. For example, the infallibility of the Pope. Yes, the Pope is infallible, not by virtue of his personal achievement, but through institution. This general, this institution, makes him holy. This is not true holiness for Father Sofroni. And our church, our Orthodox Church, is not an impersonal institute. It is not a mechanism, but a living organism, governed not by some sort of impersonal rule, not by external imposed authority, but by our relationship of love. I have to actually experience this profound difference between Orthodox monasticism and Catholic monasticism while I was a student in Oxford. My classmates once asked me, "So, you're a monk. Which order do you follow?" I didn't know what to reply. I said, "Well, in the Orthodox Church, we don't have orders. We have disorder." So, I follow this disorder, I guess. Indeed, our obedience is not to the rule. Our obedience is to a person. And we live by this personal relationship. For Father Sofronie, it was very important to emphasize this. When we come to Father George Fomorowski and his idea how dogma affects our life, we see a different approach. He said that Christology affects our life very much. And when he speaks about this idea of filioque and the papacy, he sees that it is a result not of distorted vision of the Trinity, but of Christ. Misunderstanding about where Christ is. He says that the ascension of Christ was misunderstood in such a way that historical and ontological planes became disjoint. Basically what he writes, if you want to explain the institution of papacy, you must explain where Christ is at the moment. To put it simply, for the Catholics, the Pope replaced the absent Christ who ascended into heaven. Personally, I believe, Father George writes, that theology should begin not with the mystery of the Holy Trinity, but with the mystery of the Incarnation. He writes, Father George, "We know the mystery of the Trinity only because one of the Trinity became man. Otherwise, we shall fall into metaphysics and never reach theology." Well, Father Sofronie questions this. The Trinity, metaphysics? No way. One cannot blame Father George for such attitude. If you look at Christendom and Christianity as a whole, and particularly at Protestantism, there has been a tendency, summarized by modern theologian Robin Perry, for many Christians, the Trinity has become something akin to an appendix. It is there, but they are not sure what its function is. They get by in life without it, doing very much. And if they had to have it removed, they wouldn't be too distressed. Or as Petin Toon says, that there is a general feeling that the Trinity is both difficult and unimportant. Well, Father Sofronie's theology changes this balance. Not only his theology, but also his life and his monastery. Father Sofronie lived the Holy Trinity. He discovered the ascetic implications of the dogma of the Trinity. And this discovery perhaps was his most significant contribution to modern Orthodox theology and spirituality. The Trinity became for Father Sofronie his ascetic project. If you look at the patristic ideas about the Trinity, we see that fathers don't speak much about the image of God in man as the reflection of the Trinity. So Father Sofroni refocuses our attention that we as human beings are created in the image of the Trinity. What does it mean when God says, let us create man in our image and likeness? It means that we are created in the image of this Trinity, for whom the relationship between the persons of the Trinity constitute the very essence of their life. The same for us. Our relationship is a reflection of this divine image. Every kind of relationship of love. And we have many ways how this love between the persons of the Trinity is reflected in our human relationship. We have relationship of love between husband and wife, between wife and husband, and family, all kinds of love that we encounter in human relationship is a reflection of this divine image. But for Father Sofroni, of course, it was reflected in monastic life. Of course, the Russians would explore the implications of the Trinity from the 19th century. It was actually Nikolai Fyodorov's phrase, the Trinity is our social project. For the first time, would see the importance of the dogma. And if we speak about such people as Bulgakov and Florensky, they would develop the idea of the Trinity applied to mankind to a considerable extent. But it was Father Sofroni who applied in practice to his monastic community all that modern Russian theology would achieve in theory. In his testament, final articulation of his will for the community, he wrote, the monastic community sets out to achieve unity in the image and likeness of the Holy Trinity. Each one of us, in some sense, within his own hypostasis, is the center of all. There is no one greater, no one lesser. And I personally believe that this testament should be taken on by any monastic kinovia, by any monastic community. The Trinity becomes the prime model and target of all our monastic endeavors to achieve this love that we find in our divine prototype. When our monastery was set up in Essex in 1959, local residents were quite concerned about our presence. They didn't know much about Orthodox monasticism, and they saw these strange men with beards and black cassocks. And one of the locals asked his bishop, who are these people? Are they kind of a sect? At least, do they believe in the Holy Trinity? The local bishop said, oh, don't worry, they are Orthodox. They are the ones who invented the Trinity in the first place. Well, I would continue and say they're not only who invented, but also practice the Trinity. Trinitarian theology was embodied in Father Sofroni's community. How? If you put unity as the ultimate goal of monastic endeavors, unity of the community, then unity in itself becomes an instrument. This unity reshapes us. This doesn't mean that we lose our personality, our character in this impersonal whole. No, on the opposite. That's why Father Sofroni didn't like army-like discipline in the monasteries. He said once discipline, which is imposed on a monk, is introduced, imposed by authority or by threat, then we are losing the very essence of the institution of monasticism. Once Father Sofroni was asked by one of the monks, Mantatas. This monk was offered to take up a position of an abbot in one of the Athenite monasteries. And he said, Father Sofroni, should I take this offer, or should I reject it? And Father Sofroni replied to him, you can accept this offer on three conditions. Your main ministry should be to keep the church services. Secondly, you should constantly pray for the fathers. And finally, you shouldn't interfere with their life. To understand this reply of Father Sofroni, this answer, we should also refer to other incident on Mount Athos with Father Paisi. One of the monks came to him and asked, Father Paisi, what should I do with my monastery? It was an abbot. And Father Paisi replied, keep your monastery as disorganized as possible. Why? In order to give more space to this personal development of monks, personal development of each of the members of the community. And Father Sofroni would always focus on this attitude of Christ to people around him, to his existential gestalt, if I may say so. Christ came into this world not to be served, but to serve. To lay his life as a ransom. He served God, the Father, as God, the Son. He served people as human being. But he never served himself. It was the essence of his hypostasis. And community helps very much to grow within us this existential gestalt, this attitude to other people. And believe me, in a monastery, in a community, any personal fail, any personal passion, to put it bluntly, becomes visible, becomes manifest, becomes highlighted, like passing through X-rays within the life of the community. And on the other hand, everything within us that to do with our ministry to other person and persons is brought to the forefront. Everything what is not I is but being towards the others is brought within us. Father Sofroni writes, the person doesn't determine himself by opposition or isolation. His attitude is that of love. Love is the most profound content of his being. And Father Sofroni said, in our monastic life, if we do not learn to love, then I do not find any justification for monasticism as a way of life. Monasticism is a form of love. That's why Father Sofroni would be concerned about the perfection of our relationship within our community. Yes, perfection. Any small dissonance of disunity would be immediately highlighted by him. He was concerned that monks and nuns don't allow even a thought against a brother or sister. He said that once you accept even a thought against a brother, then the body of the community is fractured, because the energy of thought will inevitably manifest itself in action or word or even look or even in silence. I recall once an incident when Father Sofroni called an emergency meeting of the whole community because one of the members of the community said unkind words to another member. For Father Sofroni, these unkind words were an emergency. Father Sofroni would call such words parole mortelle, the lethal words. Of course, it was his teacher, Saint Silvan Diaconite, who imparted to Father Sofroni this vision of monasticism. For Saint Silvan, our brother is our life. We cannot be more Trinitarian than this. Even within the Trinity, we find that the life of one person is constituted by life of the other person. And you won't find such focus on relationship, when relationship as seen as the very essence of Orthodox spirituality, in any other religion or even in any other Christian confession, especially in such religions as Judaism or Islam. In henotheistic vision of God, there is no space for relationship, divine-like relationship. For us, there is. We are Christian monotheists. Our God is the God of the Trinity. So we see that on every level, the dogma of the Trinity is not metaphysics, as Father George would imply, but it is reality of our life. It expresses, for Father Sofroni, it expresses itself in prayer. We pray for others, and we grow in our love to embrace even larger number of people, more and more and more. Eventually we start to pray for the whole world as for ourselves. And then we realize the unity of mankind, both realize for ourselves, but also realize in prayer the image of God that is given to us as a potential to embrace the whole of mankind and live it as one single body. For Father Sofroni, his monastery was a microcosm. A microcosm which reflected the life of the whole world. Indeed, Father Sofroni would warn us that through each one of us would pass the, as he would put it, the waves of the life of the whole world. Each one of us would bear a burden or reflect a condition of the life of the world. And every personal victory, when you establish a good relationship with any member of the community, will become a universal victory. Father Sofroni used to say that if you manage to live in peace and unity with such and such member, it means you are able to live with millions of people like him or like her. This is our personal contribution to Christ's struggle for unity in the Garden of Gethsemane. In Gethsemane, Christ prayed, "Let them all be one as we are one." It is our actual synergy, our working together with Christ's grace to achieve this unity. That's how our life there is completely different dimension. To achieve this unity, this prototype, Trinitarian prototype in our small community would be a great event. A personal relationship with each member of our community. Each one of us is given as a gift. Yes, a gift, but also a challenge, a task from God, which we have to cultivate our talent that we have to cultivate to achieve victory on this small personal level, to establish a loving relationship with this member of the community. With this or that member of the community. And for us, will be our universal victory, our contribution to Christ's victory on the cross, where he brought all people together. Unity. Father Sofroni was very much concerned for unity, and he said once that there are two things which I'm afraid about in our monastery, he said. First is misunderstanding between sisters, and secondly, nationalism. And today, this is the final point which I thought to raise, nationalism. For Father Sofroni, it was extremely important. His monastery, his microcosm, was multinational. And to achieve unity between members of different nationalities would be recreating a world in miniature to contribute to the peace in the whole world in a very practical way. Indeed, every member of our community represents one nation or the other. It adds responsibility to our personal responsibility in our monastery, to each member. Because we know you are responsible for behavior of your own nation in one way or the other. And Father Sofroni was particularly worried if nationalism would arise or prevail in the heart of one member or the other. Father Sofroni would say that if you are nationalist, then you must know that you are in darkness. Once Father Sofroni was told by one of the visitors, this visitor said to Father Sofroni, Father Sofroni, let's face it. It is impossible to overcome nationalism within oneself, within one's heart in particular, or in the church in general. To which Father Sofroni replied, then salvation is impossible. That's how important was this question of Father Sofroni. But the same importance it had for Father George Florovsky. He himself suffered with this, how to say, handicapped vision of Orthodoxy, where people would see their churches as an appendix to their national cultures, or to see Orthodoxy, their faith, as a culture, not as faith, when Orthodoxy is nationalized. Father George complained to Father Sofroni. He wrote, Archbishop Nicodemus really disappointed me. And surprised me by his question, he asked me, don't you regret, Father George, deep down, if you are not in the Russian church where you were baptized? To which I replied, Father George writes, to which I replied with bewilderment, I never thought that that church exists, that I was baptized in the Russian church. There's only one Orthodox Church. And he continues his comment. The Archbishop, this denigration of and oblivion of the universality and Catholicity of Orthodoxy really offends me and hurts me. Of course, he found in Father Sofroni a very close friend who would be aching in his heart to see Orthodoxy reduced to national culture. In conclusion, I think we come now in time, it's time for conclusion. I just want to mention a few points. Why I find Father Sofroni's legacy so inspiring? Firstly, because it allows us to see that Orthodoxy is not confined to the age of the fathers only. It is yet so much alive. It is yet has so much to discover, to develop within this rich legacy of our Orthodox tradition. This was an example which I saw in Father Sofroni. And when we speak about relationship between theology and asceticism, in Father Sofroni we deal with an unprecedented ascetic theology. No one, to my knowledge, as far as I know, has so closely applied theology to practice, especially when we speak about the Trinitarian theology. And thirdly, I believe that Father Sofroni's vision, combined with his ascetic implications of this vision, have far-reaching implications for our Orthodox spirituality in the 21st century. He laid the foundations for our century. The spiritual life of any Orthodox Christian is now no longer thinkable without this vision of the Trinity. The Trinity as our main objective in our life. It is relevant not only to our community, relevant to any monastic community, and not only monastic. It is relevant to any unit, social unit, be it the church, family, especially family, or any group of people. So, that was Father Sofroni's legacy, the Trinity as our program, as our typical, as our life, for which we are very grateful to him. I think I would like to stop here. Invite you to ask questions for the time. Thank you very much. So perhaps if you have any comments, I'll be very grateful, or any questions, I'll be very happy to answer or to discuss. It's very difficult sometimes to start questions because people sometimes are embarrassed. But I usually say to, when I speak in front of an audience, believe me, I'm embarrassed no less than you. Please.
You mentioned that Father Sofroni began his correspondence with Kowalski in 1929. Could you perhaps, do you have any more information than that? What he wrote about, did he continue? Yes. Correspondence?
Yes. In his correspondence, they discussed mainly, first half of the correspondence is dedicated to the publication of St. Siloan, and I quoted some of the opinions of Father George about St. Siloan from correspondence, but also from his introduction to Father Sofroni's book on St. Siloan.
Yes, I'm familiar with his later correspondence, but specifically like when Father Sofroni was on the Holy Mountain, so
no,
it seems very
yes,
early.
Yes. Unfortunately, the correspondence stops in 1929 and resumes after Father Sofroni goes to Paris, because he asked Father Florovsky, Father George, to help him with the publication. That's the reason why they resumed their correspondence. So. Unfortunately, we have no letters, at least in our archive, which would be written in the time of when Father Sofroni was in Mount Athos. Father George knew St. Siloan. They even had, probably, they had exchange of letters, but unfortunately we don't have it.
Okay.
So here we are. They also discuss ecclesiastical questions, but that was the main question which I raised. Father Sofroni submitted to Father George main ideas of his theology to check if he is in line with the Orthodox thinking. A very humble act, I would say. Father Sofroni, who knew St. Siluan, who was an Athenite monk, to commend and to submit all his theological ideas for so-called checking or test by a distinguished Orthodox theologian like Father George Florovsky was, it was an act of subornost. Father Sofroni never trusted himself fully unless his experience was confirmed by the church fathers in particular, and theologians in general. So, and he writes about it in his books, especially We Shall See Him As He Is, that any, it is for us as monks important to find confirmation for our personal experience within this subordinate experience of Catholic experience of the Church in general. And for me it was an act of subornist. So when Father Sofroni is at times accused of one or the other dogmatic deviations, I wouldn't worry so much. He did and acted as a true Orthodox ascetic monk who humbly submitted to the judgment of the Church in the face of Father George Florovsky, in the person of Father George Florovsky, his life, his vision, and his theology. So what he received was, reply was approved. So, and they spoke also about the problem of hierarchy in the Church. In passing, Father Sofroni always has held our hierarchy in great esteem. But sometimes certain misunderstandings would cause him profound suffering because of this desire for obedience and reverence towards hierarchy. For him, any misunderstanding would be very painful. They discuss this issue as well. Hierarchy and its place in the body of the Church. Father Sofroni had this vision of inverted pyramid, as you might know from the book of St. Siluan. He said that in secular pattern, second model of authority, you have a pyramid where you have the hierarch, the king, on top of the pyramid. And then you have ministers and so on, and then the working class at the bottom. In Christ and in the Church, we have inverted vision of this pyramid. Christ is at the bottom of the pyramid, carrying the weight and the difficulties, the burden of the whole body of mankind. And the closer you are to Christ, the more burden you have, the more weight you carry. That's why when St. Paul writes, if you want to become a bishop, maybe it's a good thing. Because not everyone will want to become a bishop because of this vision of the ministry of a bishop who is carrying the burden of his flock. So Father Sofroni had these ideas in correspondence as well. So if you have any other questions, I would be very
happy. Father Sofroni was sending his monks to study theology. Where did he take inspiration from this? Obviously, advised it by someone like Father George.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you. In fact, in a book which is being prepared right now for publication, which is called A Spiritual chapters on spiritual life. He decided to publish his ideas in chapters, and we have a first century of chapters on spiritual life. He discusses a question of theological education for his monks. And he said that it would be better, of course, to have first a personal experience of God and then to send people to study, to make them understand what they have experienced. That would be natural progression in theological studies and theological education. But because of our contemporary challenges of our times, it is inevitable that monks and church ministers should have theological education. It was essential. It wasn't central, but it was absolutely essential for him that monks would be theologically well versed. One of the things he was concerned about to instill the attitude of respect towards monks, because monks in the Orthodox Church, as you might know, not often respected. That what was Father Sofronie's experience with some of the professors, not only his experience, that the attitude to monasticism was rather monks were treated without respect. People believe that monasticism is not important for our church. Actually, one of the people who said this was Father Sergei Bulgakov. When Father Sofronie was in Paris, he would confess to Father Sergei Bulgakov. It wasn't that he was a spiritual father, but Father Confessor. It was different. And he would say, he said to Father George that I want to become monk. And Father Sergei Bulgakov said to him, but we are called to be soldiers of Christ in this world. There is so much evil in this world. You have to overcome it. And you're running away from this battle. First of all, of course, didn't say anything. Everything he saw, he was full of evil, he himself. And before I overcome this evil within myself, how could I help others to overcome evil? My starting point is me, myself. So that was Father Sergius Bulgakov's advice, to stay. He said that the good things may become the worst enemy of the best ones. So, and that's what the reality of Father Sofronie. So he advised, of course it would be natural for monks first to have ascetic experience and then to study. And he makes an observation which for me is very important. I studied music when I was young, and I planned to be a professional musician. And I know that if you don't have a talent developed before your studies, no way academic studies can bring out this talent within you. The same with theology. People are surprised why sometimes people who finish seminaries don't become priests. Why not interested in the church ministry? And that, I think, explains why Father Sofronie was concerned that this prior experience of God, ascetic experience of God, is an important element which should precede theological studies. So, because afterwards, you might end up with this result, that students wouldn't be wanted to serve in the church. It's a phenomenon which you find in many seminaries within the Orthodox countries like Russia, Romania, etc., or Greece. So that's what I would think what Father Sofronie would say. Father George was particularly, he complains in this correspondence that sometimes Orthodox students have no interest in theology. And that's what Father Sofroni said. They had no experience of God and they're not interested in theology. When Vladimir Losky's book, Mystical Theology of the Eastern Church, was published in English, I think about 1950s, 1960s probably, Father George writes to Father Sofroni, all the Protestant students read the book with greatest interest and they were discussing it in kulwars and everywhere. None of the Orthodox students even bothered to look at it. That's why he writes about this cross of loneliness. It is not, it is just a fact of life. And when Father Sofroni's monks were in Paris, most of the courses were based on patristic literature. And naturally, most of them were monks, the fathers of the church. But when the presence of actual monks were there in the classroom, it wasn't welcomed as it should have been. So that's why I read the letter which you had. So if you have any other question, I'll be very happy to answer. Discuss. If not, it will be a perfect time to end our session because it's 8:15. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Father.